that you've heard, a lot of you heard, some of you have not heard. Now what I try to do is I try to cut this message down, and I try to chop some things out to shorten it that I might bring just a little bit of a shorter devotional message here tonight. And in my crazy thinking, this is what I do. I reduce the font to a smaller font, so it's harder for me to see, which makes less pages. That gives me the mental stability and the emotional effort of thinking that this is a shorter message. Amen. Lord, help me tonight. Amen. But no, really, I just want a great passage in the Word of God, Luke chapter 9. If you're interested in learning about the Word of the Lord, I think there's some great things in this passage right here. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Amen. Lord, help me tonight. I tripped and fell right here on the stairs. I was worshiping the Lord, had my eyes closed. God, help me. Amen. If you saw that on video, edit that out. Amen. Praise the Lord. Oh, glory to God. Luke chapter 9, and look at verse 27. And Jesus says here in verse 27, but I tell you, truly, there are some standing here who shall not taste death till they see the kingdom of God. Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm ready for the coming of Christ. To see the kingdom of God is to experience salvation. It is to experience the life-changing power of God in your life. The kingdom of God is Christ himself. He is the kingdom of God. But when you experience him, when you experience Christ in your life, you have seen and tasted and seen the kingdom of God. Now, it came to pass about 8 days after these sayings that he took Peter, John, and James and went up to the mountain to pray. Now, I like the fact that Jesus is leading his disciples to pray. Now, these are the elite. These are the ones that were very close to Jesus. But he's leading them to pray. I promise you that God is going to lead the church to pray. The devil doesn't want you to pray. The flesh doesn't want to pray. But God, he is going to lead you. The Holy Ghost is going to lead you to pray. He'll even lead you to the house of prayer. That's right. Even the house of prayer, the house of God, the house of prayer, to pray and to seek the face of God. He'll lead you to the prayer closet to pray. Verse 29, as he prayed, the appearance of his face was altered. Now, when was the appearance of his face altered? Before or after he prayed? After. It was after he prayed. And his robe became white and glistening. And behold, two men talked with him who were Moses and Elijah. Isn't that incredible? Moses and Elijah. They're alive. Hallelujah. They're with the Lord. I know that Elijah never saw death, but here's Moses. Moses died, but he's alive. Amen. The outer, this old tabernacle, this old tent, it dies, but you live forever. In verse 31, who appeared in glory and spoke of his decease or the departure of Christ, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. That means on the cross. But Peter and those with him were heavy with sleep. Notice that. Now, I want you to circle that. I want you to make a notation that Peter and those with him, Peter, James, and John, they were heavy with sleep. That's the church today. That is exactly what the church is. They are heavy with sleep spiritually. They're not awake. Now it says, and when they were fully awake, the church, what is that talking about? That's talking about revival. See, revival will bring the people to a place of being fully awake. And when they're fully awake, when the church is awake spiritually, when we're not asleep spiritually, when our senses are not dull spiritually, they saw his glory. The church will see things and experience God in ways they've never experienced before when they have revival, when they're awakened unto God. Hallelujah. Today, where the church is they're heavy with sleep. But I pray that they'll be fully awake. They saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Then it happened as they were parting from him that Peter said to Jesus, Master, it's good for us to be here. Let us make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah, not knowing what he said. You know, sometimes we say dumb things even though we mean well. Isn't that true? And you ever done that before? Yeah. And while he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them. And they were fearful as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved son, hear him. And when the voice had ceased, Jesus was found alone. But they kept quiet and told no one in those days and of the things that they had seen. That's interesting, very interesting, very, very powerful passage. Let me talk to you, devotional message here tonight. I want to talk to you about the glory of God, all right? Father, in the name of the Lord, I thank you, God, for your mercy and your grace. Father, I pray that we as a church would be fully awake. I believe, Father, right now that we're living in a time when our senses are dulled, that we are asleep spiritually, but I'm asking for revival, an outpouring of thy spirit, a move of God that would awaken the church. And I believe when the church is awakened that we'll see things and experience things of God that we've never seen or experienced before or else in a long time. We will see the glory of God. The glory of the Lord will fill the house. First of all, we want the glory of God to fill this temple, but the glory of God will fill your church and your people. And I pray this takes place soon before the coming of Christ, the rapture of the church, asking for your help, your blessing. Give us ears to hear, a hungry heart, desiring to hear of God. Father, we love and praise you. We worship you, God. Give us a fire, a desire, a hunger, a thirst for God, for the living God, for those others, God. I pray for others that they would also have a fire. God, that we would get the fire, that we not take a vacation from you, but we would get the fire. I pray, Father, in Jesus' name, amen and amen. We praise you. Hallelujah. You may be seated tonight. God bless you and glory to God. This is really a great passage in the Word of God, the glory of God, and it's a powerful passage, one that will really speak to our hearts. If we'll open our hearts, if we want to learn, if we're hungry for God, if we're hungry for the Lord, I know that God will speak to your heart. We want God's Word to penetrate our hearts. His Word is quick and powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. I mean, it gets down to where we live. Amen. God knows what to speak, how to speak, the way to say it, and the right time to speak the Word to our hearts. We want our spiritual eyes and our spiritual senses to be opened by the Spirit of God. We need the Lord to breathe on the church again. Father, I pray. I don't want us to be dull. I don't want our senses to be dull. I don't want to fall asleep spiritually. I don't want there to be a veil over our eyes. But I pray and pray for a hunger. Pray for an outpouring of the Spirit of God. Pray for the form and the latter rain. Pray that the church would catch the fire again. Hallelujah. We read about them. We talk about them. I preached about revival times of past and the olden days and things like that. That's wonderful. And I thank God we have the record of that in the history books and the church chronicles. I thank God for it. But folks, I don't want to just read about it. How about experiencing Pentecost in our own lives, in the church, and our grandchildren and our children and our great-grandchildren? And how about grandmas and grandpas and moms and dads having a fresh outpouring of the Spirit of God, that you know it's God, you know it's the Lord, you know it's heaven. It's not made up of man. It's not something we orchestrated, but you know the wind blew and the fire blazed. Hallelujah. That's what we want to see. We want to see the Lord. And I believe it's imperative that Christians and pastors and ministers and teachers and lay workers alike have an encounter with the Lord of glory. Oh, yes, we need to see Jesus as he is. Glory to God. Like John saw him on the Isle of Patmos and he fell as a dead man. Like Daniel saw him. Oh, I pray that we would see the Lord of glory. Well, who is Jesus? I know that he's Lord. I know he's God. I know he's our Savior. I know he's glorious. And the danger of today, at least in the Church of America, is that many have brought God down to a man's level or to a human level. And we look at Jesus as a good buddy or a pal or a daddy. But we must come back to the realization that Jesus Christ is not just a good buddy or a pal or a daddy, but he is Lord. Can you say that he is Lord God Almighty? He is the King of Kings and he is the Lord of Lords, and there is none other like unto him. He's not just another little God that's added to the collection of other little gods. He is God, capital G. He is Lord God Almighty, the creator of the heavens and the earth. And you can read that in the book of Colossians. The transformation of Christ was a glorious moment for Peter, James, and John. The experiences we have with the Lord, they are important. They're immense and beyond measure, and they're precious, and we can thank God for the experiences that we've had with the Lord Jesus Christ. Peter, James, and John would experience Christ in a greater degree. Peter would misunderstand because you can't put Jesus on the same level as Moses. The Hebrews talks about that. We have one that's better than Moses. We've got one that's better than the angels. Hallelujah. We have one that's better, and his name is Jesus. Jesus is not on the same level as man. Jesus is Lord, and he's the creator of the heavens and the earth, even though I got ahead of myself a little bit there just a moment ago, but I'll say it again. He is the creator of the heavens and the earth. He is the divine architect, praise God. Jesus took Peter, James, and John, the sons of thunder, thunder with them up on the mountain to pray. And I've talked about this. I don't know if y'all ever remember the message I preached one time about coming down the mountain. Anybody ever know about that? Remember that message a long time ago? I don't know what year that was, but I remember that message. They went up to the mountain to see the glory of God. But there comes a time when you have to come down that mountain and you got to continue to live for the Lord. You thank God for those encounters and thank God for those experiences that we have with the Lord. But listen, that's not the end of it. You got to continue. We come down off that mountain. You got to continue to serve God, continue to be faithful to the Lord, continue to worship Him and to be faithful unto Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Sometimes folks are only Christian on the mountain. Amen. They're not Christians when they come down that mountain. They put no effort into it whatsoever. But thank God, amen, it's here that these men experienced the transfiguration of Christ. And while Jesus was praying, notice that his countenance changed. It was altered, the Bible says. And his raiment was white and glistening. This was phenomenal. This was undoubtedly the most glorious experience Peter, James, and John had ever seen in their life. And as a Christian, we'll have had some glorious experience with Christ. How many have had some glorious experiences, do you remember, with the Lord in your Christian walk with God? Maybe God revealed his glory to you. Maybe God spoke to you, which seemed audibly to you. Whatever it might be, maybe God poured out the Holy Ghost to you. You remember the time when God saved your soul? That's a glorious experience when you got saved. You remember the time that God baptized you in the Holy Ghost? That's a glorious experience, amen. You remember the time God touched you at the altar? Maybe he touched you when you're driving your car down the road. Maybe he touched you in the house when you're doing dishes or the lawn. Or sweeping the carpet or grocery shopping or whatever it might be. All of a sudden the glory of God came unexpectedly and touched you and moved upon you. Praise God. The glory of the Lord. Praise God. I can look back. I just remember different times and different places when God showed up unexpectedly. And I love that. I love that. I believe God wants to do that. Amen. God wants to show up. God wants to bless. God wants to touch you. God wants to fill you with his glory. I've been in fast food restaurants praying over my food and the glory of God would come. I've been at work praying over my food for lunch and the glory of God would come. I promise you, my beloved, if your heart is just hungry and sincere and pure before the Lord, I know that God's glory will come and reveal himself to you. There's nothing like it. Praise God. That's your Mount of Transfiguration. That's your encounter with Jesus Christ, an experience you had with the Lord that you'll never forget, that you'll remember forever and eternity, these times that we've had with God. Praise the Lord. There are things I know that God has revealed and shown to you. There are things that have happened that has given you a greater insight of who God is. You know, the Bible talks about in Ephesians, Paul wrote this inspired of the Holy Ghost, that to pray for the spirit of revelation. Praise God. You know that God is the Ancient of Days, but God never gets old. Amen. That God can give you the spirit of revelation, an understanding of who he is according to his word. If we're hungry for God, if we're thirsty for righteousness, if we're hungry for the Lord, I know that God will open up heaven, and I know that God will show him and reveal himself to his people, and I believe that God wants to do that. Maybe we have to come back to the place where we'll be fully awake. Praise God. I know that God wants to do this and wants to reveal himself. If God doesn't reveal himself to you and you're just going through the religious routine, we can become very religious. We become very religious and our hearts become indifferent and cold and we lose our first love, where Jesus is not the most important thing in your life anymore. But now other things become more primary before God and they're more important than God. But I pray that we not become like that. I pray that we not become religious, but I pray that there would be just this hunger and desire that we want to see Jesus. Hallelujah. We want God to reveal himself and his glory to us and his word and the spirit of revelation. There are things that have happened that have given you greater insight of who he is. These are experiences that we do not want to forget. These are stepping stones that have helped in our growth and development as a Christian. Praise God. I can remember different times where God has spoken to me as if it was yesterday, that clear, that vivid. The place I was at, the time of that place, God has spoken to my heart. Now, what are some lessons that we can learn from this great passage here? There's 4 points real quickly here tonight. Number one, I know it was after that Jesus prayed. Bible said that his count and it's changed. His countenance was altered, if you will. It was after being in the presence of God, a presence of the Father, that a metamorphosis took place. Understand, there was a change. The glory began to show forth. It was there, but it was covered with flesh, if you will, embodied by Christ. But then it began to show forth, and what was on the inside was revealed on the outside. I want you to get that. I want you to understand that. Turn with me tonight to the book of Romans real quick. The book of Romans in chapter 12. Romans in chapter 12, and look at verse 1. it says here, Paul, inspired of the Holy Ghost, says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, praise God. That means separate, holy, praise God, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. In verse 2, and do not be conformed to this world. Don't be shaped, formed, or fashioned to the ways of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may be proved what is good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. And the word, of course, you know they're transformed. That's the word change. That's the word metamorphosis. It's like when a caterpillar comes out of the cocoon, it changes. A caterpillar, it's amazing how this happens, but God really gives us a picture of this in nature with the caterpillar that has a cocoon, and he's in there for a certain amount of time, and then it opens up and he becomes a butterfly, and that's the most amazing thing. And now a butterfly is flying, glory to God. There's a change that takes place. There was a change on the inside, and that change is manifested on the outside. I happened to be at my barber one day getting my hair cut, and he had some of those caterpillars in a little cage that he had. He was sitting there on the table right there. We're giving a haircut and things like this, and talking about that, you know, and a couple of those cocoons have already hatched, and there were butterflies, and he let those butterflies go, and there's one more left in there. And while I was sitting in the barber chair, while he was cutting my hair, that caterpillar decided to come out of the cocoon. So we both saw it come out of the cocoon, and it's stretching its wings, glory to God. That is a change. That is a metamorphosis, glory to God. That's what takes place here. It was revealed on the outside to be seen by Peter, James, and John. What I'm trying to tell you is God wanted his disciples to see his glory, to experience his glory. And if God wants his disciples to see his glory, I know that God wants you as his people to see and experience the glory of God, the glory of the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. Jesus wanted them to see themselves. He would not have invited them. You know, we've been invited to the banqueting table of the Lord. Amen. Praise God. We've been invited to serve him, to live for him. We can be confident to say that Jesus wanted them to see his glory. And I believe there is something that Jesus wants to show a lost and a dying world. I believe that God wants to show a lost world his glory. Yes, he does. But the question is, how does God do that? How does the Lord show a lost world the glory of the Lord? I believe it's through believers, through people, through his church, through people just like you and I that have been in the presence of God. This is what makes the difference between somebody that's religious and somebody that's been in the presence and the glory of God. You know what I'm talking about? When you're in the presence of God, you love your enemies. When you're in the presence of God, you pray for the lost. When you're in the presence of God, you have love and mercy and compassion on others. You do. There's a difference. Man, what would happen if the church was full of the glory and the presence of the Lord? We might care about others. We might be concerned about others. We might help others. We might do for others. We might pray for others. Amen. Praise the Lord. We had this man here this past week or two, and he was working on putting the glass block. And there's glass block that you can get that's a solid unit that fits into the window unit. And he had to. Those were original windows. It's an old church built in the 40s. And so he had to take a jackhammer or some kind of chipper, and he's trying to break and get those windows out of the frame and out of the concrete and everything like this. It was rather hard. He gave me a quote of how much he would charge me to do all this, which was really not that much at all. But I saw the work and the labor he's putting into this, and he ended up having to buy individual glass block. And so that means he had to concrete them in rather than buying it one solid unit. So it took him longer. And so he's working. It took him longer, but he had a right heart, a good attitude about the whole thing. And it took a couple days to finally get this, and he had to bring extra help, and he had three guys all together with him the other day. And he was working on this, and I saw the time he's putting in this, and I saw the labor, and I saw how much harder this was, I think, than what he thought. And so when it came time to pay him, I said, now we agreed on this price. He said, that's right. I said, I've already paid you half. He said, that's right. And I said, well, I said, I saw the labor, I saw the work, I saw the extra materials that you had to buy, and I know you didn't ask me, but I'm going to give you an extra $200 for your time. And you say, well, Pastor, why did you do that? I did that because I felt like the Lord wanted me to do that. And he said, you didn't have to do that. I said, I know that. I said, but I saw the work. You see, I want him to know that we're not just trying to take advantage of him. I want him to see something of God. I want him to see the glory of the Lord. And I want him to see the kindness of what Christians can be. Not rude, not mean, not Christians that don't leave tips or don't care about others, but those that are giving. I'm telling you, if you want to see a world, see the glory of God in and through the church, let the church be a giving church, a sacrificial church, a caring church, a people of compassion, a people of prayer, a people of kindness, and they'll see the glory of the Lord. And so I want him to do some work at my house, and he says, well, I'll deduct this off of what... I said, well, you do what you think you need to do. I said, but I'm doing this because I think it's the right thing to do. Amen. Praise God. I want to see the world out there to see the glory of God. I believe there's something that Jesus, he wants to show them his glory. That's right. Through believers like you and I, this is what makes the difference. How are we going to make a difference or an impact in people's lives? How can we make a difference in America or India or Australia or Thailand or South America or Philippines or in Marion, Ohio? Let them see the glory of Christ in you. Let them see that you have a true, genuine relationship with the Lord. You're not just a churchgoer. You're not just a religious person. Let them see there's something different about you. When they look at you, they'll know there's something different about you. Let them see Jesus in you. Let them see Jesus through you. We are his hands. We are his feet. We are his voice. Hallelujah. Praise God. That's what PB&J is all about. We're no strings attached whatsoever. What are we doing out there? We're trying to show them the glory of God. That's what we're doing. We're trying to show them Christ. We're showing them the love of Jesus. And there are people, I think, that see that. There's something different about us. Praise the Lord. We just want to pray for them, and we do pray for them. We want to bless them. We want to bless them with kindness. We want to bless them with the love of Jesus. This isn't just a religious. Listen, PB&J cost us. We don't get any revenue from PB&J. It cost us. But you know what? That's why we're here. Let it cost us. Jesus, it cost us. It cost him his life for us to be saved. Let it. That's why we're here, glory to God, sacrificing unto the Lord, but also so that others can see the glory and the kindness and the love, the mercy and the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not another dead religion made up in the imagination of man's heart. That doesn't change you, but Jesus changes you from within. There's a transformation, glory to God. He changes you on the inside. The Pharisees and the Sadducees were all stuck to the law, trying to conform man from the outside, but Jesus comes along and says, no, you got to change the heart. You can put a muzzle on a dog that wants to bite, and in his heart he still wants to bite. He just doesn't bite because he's got a muzzle on them, restricting him from biting, but take the muzzle off and he'll bite you. Listen, you change the heart of that dog. You don't have to have a muzzle. He won't bite. Amen. Hallelujah. That's what God does. He changes the heart. He changes the inside. He causes you to love. He causes you to have care. Amen. At times, you might wonder why we suffer. We're saved and doing the will of God, and we're ministers of God. And if we're being obedient to God, then why all the suffering and the hardships and the trials and the difficulties? Why is it so hard? I've had terrible attacks on my own health through the years. I know. Perhaps it's to bring us to the place to where we're empty of ourselves and broken so that somebody might be able to see Jesus through you. Maybe that's what God's trying to do in your life. He's trying to help us to not have an attitude so they don't see the attitude, that they see him. Get rid of the attitude and they'll see the glory of God. Amen. I know none of you had an attitude. I know that. Isn't that right, Jeffrey? We don't have attitude, do we? No. I'm talking about the guys. We're the ones with the problem with the attitude. Amen. Come on now. Help me out here. Praise the Lord. He said, preacher, that got too close to home. Well, just hold on. I'm about to park in your garage. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. That's right. You see, Paul said this. Now, listen to what Paul said in 2 Corinthians 4 and 10. Let me read this to you. I don't want to go too fast. Always caring about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body or revealed through our life. What does God want to reveal through our life? Jesus. This world doesn't need to see me. This world doesn't need to see us. It needs to see Christ. Now, I haven't always done this victoriously. I haven't always been the best at this, but I try to keep this in mind, that everything we do, everything we say, all the actions of our life, we represent the gospel. We represent the kingdom of God. Amen. I want them to see the Lord. God flows through broken people like you and I. You might be feeling like you're being crushed by the weight and difficulties of life. Many times we are. But it's through that brokenness that Jesus reveals his glory to others. It's in that brokenness that God comes new, draws near to you. Jesus is concerned about the lost. Jesus wants to save the lost. And he wants all to come to repentance and to know him as Lord and Savior. 2 Peter 3:9. But is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That's the will of God. Listen, keep that in mind in your Christian walk, in your journey, in your actions, in your reactions. Before you blow a fuse, keep it in mind. You represent Christ. You represent the kingdom of God. You represent the gospel. You are the church. What will make a difference is if the lost would world out there would be able to see Christ in and through God's children. If the lost and dying world that's hurting and in bondage can see the image of Christ through the church, there might be they might see their need for a Savior. The world is lost and hurting and in darkness, and the only hope for them is Jesus Christ. Turn with me quickly to the book of Acts in chapter 26 and verse 18. It says to open their eyes. This is the will of God, to open their eyes in order to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among those who are sanctified by faith in me. He's the one that can set them free from their captivity. He's the one that can open their blinded eyes. He's the one that can deliver them from bondage of darkness. Jesus is the only answer. There is no other alternative. There is no other program. He is the program. Jesus is the answer. Listen, it's Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Can you help me say it tonight? It's Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There is no other method. There is no other way. It is Christ. It's the power of the blood of Jesus. It's our faith in Christ. Faith is what unlocks the key. It's the key that unlocks all the spiritual blessings that we have from the Lord Jesus Christ. Let them see Jesus. You know what hurts your pastor is when my wife and I and my family work so hard to try to grow this church, and then I see somebody in here not acting like Jesus to somebody else. You are destroying our work. You are hurting us. You are hindering us. If you are not loving them unconditionally, if you're not showing them compassion, but you're not acting Christ-like, you're hurting the kingdom of God, and you're hurting God's church. And you're hurting your pastor and his wife. Just love people. Just love them. Let them see the glory of God and unconditional love. Let them see Jesus and the way we treat others. Let them see Christ in our actions and attitudes. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai after receiving the Ten Commandments, the Bible says that his face shined. The glory of God was upon Moses' countenance because he had been in the presence of the Lord. That's what makes the difference. I know whether you've been in the presence of God or not. You know when people have been in the presence of God or not. It depends on the length of their fuse. Some people have a long fuse. Some have a short fuse. The longer you spend in the presence of God, the longer fuse you have. The shorter you spend in the presence of God, you've got a shorter fuse. Amen. Praise the Lord. You see, you weren't supposed to preach a convicting message tonight. I'm just talking about these things. Listen, Moses, when the presence of the Father and others saw it, they saw the glory of God on the countenance of Moses. It's when Christians have bathed themselves in prayer and have been in pure communion with Jesus that the glory of God will begin to shine through them. They'll begin to see the glory of God flow through your life. It'll touch and minister to others. They'll see a difference in you. They'll see a transformation, a metamorphosis in you. They'll see a metamorphosis take place. They will see Jesus, who's on the inside, manifest himself on the outside. Number two tonight, experiencing God's glory doesn't doesn't exclude the truth. I thank God. It does not exclude the truth. Number two, I thank God that for all the glorious experiences that we have, that he has shown me in my Christian walk with him, but all the glorious experiences will not be contrary to the word of God. If it's God, it'll line up with his word, because God will not contradict his word. We must stick to the word of God. I don't care what anybody else does. We've got to stick to the word. That's the danger of some Christian organizations today. Some are more interested in an experience. They're just looking for some thrill of some kind. They just want goosebumps or just the shouting. When God shows up, you might have goosebumps. You might run. You might dance. You might shout. I get excited when preaching about Jesus. No doubt about that. But I'm not looking for those things. I'm looking for him. I want to see him. Just give me his glory and it'll be all right. Those other things may come, but I'm not looking for those things. I'm looking for Christ. I'm looking for God. I'm looking for the glory of the Lord. See, some are more interested in signs than the phenomenon they are of some sort, but they're not really concerned if it lines up with the Bible or not. They just want to feel or experience something. Well, you may feel something or you may not. Listen, regardless, I'm looking for Jesus Christ. Well, did it ever occur to you that we might have experiences outside of God? That's right. This whole thing is spiritual, and there are other spiritual forces behind the scene. The Bible tells us about this and warns us about this. The devil comes as a counterfeit too. He is a deceiver and a master of deception. That's right. There are ministers that portray themselves to be ministers of righteousness, but they're not of God. He comes, the devil comes as an angel of light. He's a liar and the father of lies, and we need to be careful. Peter said, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. 1 Peter 5:8. But brothers and sisters in Christ, if it doesn't line up with the word of God, we got to throw it out. Get rid of it. Just give me the true, authentic, pure, unadulterated word of God. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The word of God is our guideline for Christian living. I talked about that this morning, about getting the instructions out. This is the instruction book that God has given us. This is God's love letter to us to show us how to live a life that's pleasing unto God, and God will give us the power of the Holy Spirit to live for him according to his word. The word of God is our guideline for Christian living. Psalm 119 and verse 105. Your word is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. It gives us guidance so we don't fall into error, so we don't fall into false experiences. It must line up with the word of God. Amen. Third thing I want to say tonight is experiencing his glory brings more emphasis on the cross, not less. Look at verses 30 and 31. It speaks about Moses and Elijah talking to Jesus about his death or his departure. And they talked about Christ's exodus as they talked about his departure. They talked about the cross. That's what they were talking about. God, Jesus was talking to Moses and Elijah about the cross and that he would die for all the world. They're talking about him dying on the cross, talking about him giving his life as a ransom for many, talking about him shedding his blood on the cross. A glorious experience will bring you back to the truth of the cross. It'll bring you back to what Christ has done for you. He paid the price at Calvary. He shed his blood, gave his life so that we could be saved. What am I saying? A glorious experience that's from God will bring you back to the cross. It doesn't take you away from the cross. It doesn't take you away from faithfulness. A glorious encounter with Christ doesn't take you away from faithfulness. I see a great deal of the church unfaithful today. And you know I'm telling the truth. It doesn't take you away from holiness. I'm seeing a trend of the modern day so-called church today. It's not moving towards holiness. When I see tennis shoes, shorts, T-shirt, and a ball cap on the platform representing Christ from a praise band trying to lead God's people in the presence of the Lord, that I do not want. You have a false representation. You say, well, do you have to be in a suit? No, I'm not saying that either. You're putting words in my mouth. But I'm saying we let go of some things today. We've let go of our convictions. We've let go of things like holiness. And I find that the church is trying to dress like the world and act like the world and talk like the world and play music like the world. And yet they say that they represent Christ. They do not. I cannot imagine people being around the throne right now, looking like the world, acting like the world, dressing like the world, and playing music like the world to the Lord in glory. The Bible said that the angels, the seraphim, they're crying out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of glory." They're worshiping God in holiness. They're worshiping God in purity. How should you dress? The Bible says modestly. How should you act? The same way Jesus would act. I'm very thankful for a church, and I'm thankful. And listen to me. Let it stay small as long as it stays right. Just forget it. You can have your big churches. If they're going to go wayward and they're going to compromise and they're going to get into false doctrine, they're going to be like the world, you can have it. They say they've got something. They don't have anything. Just give us a few that know God. Give us a few that know the presence of God, that know the glory of God, that know the Lord and have a heart for God. Hallelujah. And that will represent Him properly. There is a false spirit. And you've even got pastors today that cannot even recognize the difference between the spirit of God, the spirit of holiness, the spirit of righteousness, and that which is of a false spirit. They can't tell the difference. They cannot discern what is God and what is not God. I'm talking about leadership. I'm talking about pastors. I don't know why in the world some people would sit under somebody like that. I want to hear a preacher that's heard from God. I want to hear a preacher that's heard from heaven. I want a preacher that's anointed by the power of the Holy Ghost. I want a preacher that spent some time in the presence of God seeking His face and has got a word from the Lord. I want a preacher that knows that holy book and knows how to preach it, knows how to teach it, knows how to touch the hearts of the people. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. I want a preacher that has conviction, that knows what he's talking about and knows what he's preaching. And you, well, or anybody else. I just want somebody. You know what I'm talking about. I know. I know. Well, give him glory then. Give him glory. 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 Hallelujah. Lord God, let us have a proper representation. He wants to bring you back to where your victory is. He wants to bring you back to where your salvation is. He wants to bring you back to where your healing is. He wants to bring you back to where your provision is. He wants to bring you back to where it all began. It all began at the cross. That's where you got saved. That's where you're born again. That's where you became a new creature in Christ. In a glorious encounter with God, the cross becomes more central, not less. Notice this. We become more controlled, not less controlled. Salvation is emphasized more, not less. His second coming is even more apparent, not less. We are less consumed with ourselves and more consumed with Christ. Oh. We're less consumed with ourselves and we're more consumed with Him. Number four. When experiencing His glory, it's centered around Jesus. Notice the whole experience was centered on Jesus. Notice this. Verse 35, I'm almost finished. Amen. And a voice, look at verse 35. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my beloved Son, hear Him." Now, where is the focus? Jesus, okay? So what Jesus says is what we need to hear. A glorious encounter, an experience, or a revival, or a good church service should always be focused on Christ. That's the way God and the Holy Ghost wants it. Jesus said, "The Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from my Father, He shall testify of me." Talking about Christ, John 15 and 26. John 15 and 26, "which proceedeth from the Father, He shall testify of me." In other words, the spotlight goes on Jesus, not man. If there's a true move of God, then the focus will be on Jesus, not denomination, not the church name, not even the pastor. The focus will be on Christ. Jesus will be lifted up and Jesus will be glorified. Jesus said, "If I am lifted up, then I will draw all men unto me." See, what we got to do here at this church, lift up Jesus. What do we need to do here? Glorify Jesus. Worship Jesus. Magnify Jesus. Preach Jesus. Amen. And then God will draw the hearts of men to Himself. Now, the mistake that Peter made was that he was trying to put Moses and Elijah on the same level as Jesus. Look what Peter said in Luke 9 and 33. He said, let us make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah. But you can't do that. You see, Jesus is not on the same level as Moses. Jesus is not on the same level as Elijah or any great man or woman of God. Jesus is greater. No one is equal to Jesus, for we know that Jesus is Lord. Colossians 1:18, that in all things he may have preeminence. Colossians 1:18, in all things that he might have preeminence. This means that in everything in your life, that Jesus is to have supremacy. Jesus is not to sit in the back seat. He's not co-pilot. He's driving. You're sitting in the back seat. Let Jesus drive your car. I know how some of you about your car. Ain't nobody can drive my car. No, you let Jesus drive your car. Amen. Oh, honey, don't look at me like that. It's an ongoing thing with my wife and I, is that when we go someplace, I want her to drive. I've been driving all day long. In the school bus, you're driving all the time. And she goes, oh, I want you to drive. I said, honey, I've been driving all day long. Well, okay. And so she'll drive. Amen. But you know what? When it comes to Jesus, you need to let go of the wheel and let him drive 24/7. Let Christ have supremacy. What am I saying? Let him rule and reign in your life. Let him rule. Let God make decisions for you and you follow his decisions. A lot of marriages are in trouble and jeopardy, and the husband and the wife fight all the time because she wants her way, he wants his way. But if the husband and the wife would come together and say, you know what, we're going to pray about this, and we just want God's way. We want God's will. It is healthy for the marriage. It's healthy for the church. There are churches that split because they want their way and their will and yada, 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 yada. How about praying about it and asking for the will of God? Let go of the wheel and let Jesus drive. Amen. Let him lead. Let him guide. Let him have all supremacy. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. No one is equal to Jesus, for we know that Jesus is Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Amen. Jesus must have first place. It means Jesus is to have the place of dominance. He's Lord of the heart, of the home, of the marriage, of the ministry, of the church. He's our all in all. Christ has supremacy. We as ministers of the gospel and ambassadors of the Lord Jesus Christ and of the church, the ecclesia, the called out ones, saints of God, of the Lord, the gospel of Jesus Christ, must have these encounters with Jesus. Dead religious works will not show a lost world who Jesus is, but let them see Jesus in you and through you. And when we take the time to spend in his word and his presence, it makes all the difference. Thailand, China, America, India, South America, wherever, Russia, Africa, they don't need another God to add to the plurality of gods that they already believe in. They need to see Jesus. They need to see God through his church. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is God. Jesus is the Savior of the world. Praise God. Let them see Jesus. Let them see God. I was sharing this the other day with Pastor Jerry and Sister Karen as we were having lunch. We went to Put-in Bay last Monday, and just, he has a convertible. It's an old 1991 Chrysler LeBaron. You remember those? And so they took us in that convertible up to Put-in Bay. And we got on the ferry, and we went across in the ferry, and we were in the car, and we were driving around the island, acting like we're teenagers when we're not. It was great. I loved it. And I was telling him about the story of a guy I used to work with at Exxon. He was an engineer. He was from India. He was a guru, a teacher in India. And I've shared some of this with the church, but let me share with you in case you haven't heard it. And I was working with him, and I would go into his office, and I would try to win him to Christ, and I would declare that Jesus is Lord, and I was trying to share with him how Jesus died for him, and just trying to win him to Jesus, trying to win him to the Lord. And there was one day, I don't know, I was either I was in church and maybe I heard a message about Elijah, or I was reading about Elijah or something like this, but I walked in that office on a Monday morning and he was in there. And I said, put away your false gods and accept the only true God, the Lord Jesus Christ, as your Savior. Man, with such boldness and such powers, I was thinking in my mind he was going to fall on his face and weep and cry and accept the Lord. I thought I had the power of Elijah's call fire down from heaven or something like this, you know. But he looked at me and he stared at me in silence. And then he broke the silence and he said, I can't. You see, he was truly considering what I was saying, and I was trying to reach him with the gospel of Christ. I was trying to witness to him, but he said, I can't. And I remember when his mom had died, and he had to fly back to India. And when he flew back to India, in their ritual, in their religion, he had to shave his head, and he put ashes all over him. And there's a certain period of time of mourning. And he was gone for about a month, and he came back to Exxon and came back to work, and his head was shaved, and he still had ashes. And I don't know how long they do that, but he had ashes. And I know the other guys were laughing at him and chuckling at him and kind of mocking him a little bit, but I wasn't mocking him, because I, even though I knew that what he believed in was wrong, I knew that he believed in it, and I wasn't going to mock him, and he knew I did not mock him. And I know he recognized and took note of that. There was a time in my office, in my cubicle, and I was about to eat lunch, and I was praying over my lunch, and all of a sudden, the glory of God came. This is one of those times, one of those experiences, where God brought me up to the Mount of Transfiguration, and all of a sudden, the glory of God came all over me. I could not eat. I couldn't think about food. All I could do was worship God. I was worshiping God. I was praising God. I was glorifying the Lord in my office. And after about 20, 25 minutes or so, the glory lifted, and I had just a few minutes, and I quickly ate my lunch, and then I went to the center of the department where there's a sink there, and you can rinse your dishes off, because I was trying to be a good husband and clean my dishes before I brought them home, because I brought dishes home one time that weren't clean, and I'll never forget that. You know what I'm talking about, ladies. And so I was just standing, Jay Patel was at the sink, and I could feel the presence of God. I was basking in the presence of the Lord, and I had been crying, I'd been weeping. Jay didn't know I was behind him, and then all of a sudden he finished, and he turned around and he looked at me, and he said this, he said, what happened to you? Now this is a man that's not saved, but he's religious, and he said, what happened to you? And I said, what do you mean, Jay? What do you mean, what happened? He said, no, he said, there's something different about you. Something happened to you. And he kept staring at me. And I said, well, Jay, I said, it's the Lord. I said, God, he just came and visited me when I was in my cubicle praying over my lunch. The glory of the Lord came. And that Hindu guru, that's from India, he was speechless. I tell you the God's honest truth, that this man didn't know what to think. He didn't know what to say, but he was speechless. And all he could do was stare at me. I did not know it then what I know now. But I know what God was trying to do. God had come and he had visited me with his glory, showered me with his presence. I bathed and basked in the glory and the presence of the Lord. I wept before God, not just for my benefit, although I was a recipient of the touch of God. And I remember this encounter. I remember this experience. It was wonderful. And here I am today testifying about this encounter I had with the Lord. But it wasn't just for Mark Malden. God was trying to reveal his glory to Jay Patel. That's what God was trying to do. And God may want to fill you. God may bless you with his glory and his presence. Because God wants to reveal himself to a lost and dying world. Just words wasn't enough to try to win Jay Patel to the Lord. He had to see something different that he'd never seen before. And that's what makes the difference. That's why these church services are so important. That's why prayer is so important. That's why hearing the Word of God is so important. That's why corporate worship is so important. You know, we're getting in a time in a day where people say, well, I could just stay home and watch it on television or watch it on the Facebook, whatever. Okay, if you can't make it, that's one thing. If you're sick and you can't make it, that's one thing. But you're missing out on the glory and the presence of God and the will of God by coming together as a body of Christ, worshiping the Lord together, as the Bible tells us to do, so that God can come and pour out himself, that we might encounter the Lord in his glory and his power and his presence, that when we leave here, when we hit that office on Monday, when we go to the workplace tomorrow or the next day, that that world out there might see that there's something different about you. The countenance, what's changed about you. There's something different in your look. There's something different in your eyes. Something's different about you. What happened? I'll tell you what happened. I was in the glory and the presence of God. Where were you? I was in church with the church, having church with Jesus. But some folks will never get it. They'll never, ever, ever get it. They don't think it's important. They think that their measure of faith is not important. But notice what the scripture says. Look at Luke chapter 9. Look at verse 32. But Peter and those with him were heavy with sleep. That's where it's at. And no matter what you do, no matter what you say, no matter what, they won't get it because they can't see. They don't have the revelation of it because they're heavy with sleep spiritually. I don't know about you, but there's only one person in this church that I know that they can sleep so deep and sound that they can't hear tornadoes or thunderstorms coming to this. And that's Sister Jan Ben. Trees are blowing down. Power lines are blowing down. People out with electricity for a week. And Sister Jan says, I didn't hear a thing. Brother John, you better check on your wife during the night. She's the only one I know that can be so sound asleep that she's near death. Isn't that the truth? There's a lot of people in the church that are so sound asleep that they're near death. You hear me? They're so sound asleep that they're near death. But when they were fully awake, they saw the glory of God. Amen. Let's stand together tonight. Praise the Lord. God, awaken your church. Amen. God, awaken your church. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Show me your glory, God. That was a short devotional message tonight. Just remember that. Short devotional message tonight. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. I shared that not long ago with my brothers in India. And the Lord, I shared that same devotion to them. And I told them, I said, those pastors over there in India, and I said, if you're going to try to win these people to Christ, and you're going to try to tell them about Jesus and to put away their other false gods and accept the Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior, I said, you're going to have to reveal Christ to them. That's it. You're going to have to reveal Christ to them. They're going to have to see him. They're going to have to see the Lord. I want God. I want the world to see Christ in me. I think that you can examine your own heart here tonight. Do they see a religious person, or do they see the love of Christ in you? Do they see the mercy of God in you? Do they see the grace of God in you? Does the world out there see the compassion of Christ? What do they see? What do they see in you? Do they see faithfulness in you? Do they see the lack of faithfulness in you? What do they see in us? I pray, by the help and the grace of God, I pray that they would see Christ. God wants to reveal himself through you to a lost world. Hallelujah. How about you, church? Are you willing? Are you willing? Amen. Praise the Lord. Why don't we just take a moment here tonight where you are? You don't have to come up here, but why don't we just pray? This message has spoken to our heart. Why don't we just pray? God, do this work in me. God, do this work in me. God, I want to see you. I want to be fully awake, God. I want your glory. I want a hungry heart for you. I not just want to be religious. I don't want to be just a churchgoer, but I want to experience Christ. Why don't you pray? Why don't you just, in your own way, you just cry out to the Lord. God, I want to encounter Christ. I want to see him. Hallelujah. Glory to the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Oh, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, sing that, Abby. Sing that as we worship the Lord tonight. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to the Lord. Jesus, my Lord. Oh, Lord, we praise you, Jesus. Worship the Lord. Just worship him. Worship him tonight. Hallelujah. Oh, I feel the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus. Jesus. God Almighty. Lord. Hallelujah. That's what it is right there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, I praise you. Hallelujah. Let the church praise him. Let the church draw near to him. Let the church fellowship with him. Let the church adore him. You are the church. You are the church. You are the church. Hallelujah. Glory. Glory. Glory, Jesus. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Lord, we worship you. Glorify you, Lord. Oh, Lord, Jesus. feel the prompting of the Holy Spirit drawing you to Christ? Do you feel the river of God flowing in your heart? Is there something that's just tugging you, that's drawing you to Himself? Because God's not dead, He's alive. And God's not a respecter of persons. If you will allow Him, if you're hungry, I know that God will draw you to Himself, to fellowship with Him and to sup with Him and to worship Him. Hallelujah. I pray that there are people at Word of Life that hunger for His presence and His nearness. Oh, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord, my God. Oh, we praise You, Lord. Oh, we praise You, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord God. My Lord. Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Presence of the Lord tonight, church. Bask in the presence of God. I love You, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship You. Oh, my soul, rejoice. Savior. Lord, we praise You, Jesus. Praise God. Oh, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord, for Your sweet Holy Spirit tonight. Sweet Holy Presence tonight, Lord. You see, this is what the church needs to get back to. Waiting on the Lord, worshiping, praising Him, serving him, dining with him, communing with him. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. Almighty God, we acknowledge your presence. You are Lord. God supreme in our lives, the Lord of glory. Let him reveal himself to you. Oh, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. He's a good God, church. Amen. He's a good God. Do you love the Lord? Then let's make it an effort to spend more time in his presence and in his glory. Brother Clint, it's good to see you tonight. I hope you're feeling better. Praise God. Amen. Yes, sir. Get folks healed up. Amen. Get them healed up and praise the Lord. God's good. Lord's gracious, and I thank him for his goodness. I thank him for his word. I appreciate every single one of you. It's just good to meditate upon the Lord and spend time in the presence of God, isn't it? Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this time as a body of Christ tonight. What a glorious time as we've been in your presence. The time of worship was phenomenal. Your presence and your glory in this house, the songs, the courses we sang, Lord, under your name and your presence and your nearness as we supped with you tonight, as we dined with the Lord, I thank you, Father. Father, thank you for the body of Christ. I pray for my brothers and sisters, and I'm asking you to bless them. Bless them for just their faithfulness to you, Lord, their devotion to Christ. But God, just bless them. For the service tonight and the word of God, I thank you, Father. Let it minister and penetrate our hearts. I pray, Father, that the world out there will see something different in it. They'll see the glory of God and upon our faces, through our lives. They would hear Jesus and see Jesus through your people, the church, the ecclesia, the called out ones, the ambassadors of the Lord Jesus Christ. We represent the gospel. We represent you. So, Father, I pray in the name of the Lord. Strengthen my brothers and sisters. Bless them. Heal them, Father. Protect them from sickness, oh God. Protect them from the powers of darkness, that them rise up in the power and the Spirit of Almighty God. That they would have the fire of God burning within them, revival. That they'd be fully awake, Father, and they would encounter the glory of the Lord themselves. Lord, use us as intercessor warriors to pray for the lost and to pray for others, Lord. I pray in this time and day that we're living in. Father, we love and praise you. We bless you tonight. We glorify the Lord. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Amen. Tell someone you love them tonight. Appreciate them tonight. God bless you. This is the church that we're building, the church of God that we're building. Praise the Lord. The kingdom of God that we're building. Praise the Lord. Amen. Be a blessing to somebody. Be a blessing to somebody. Praise the name of the Lord. Have a wonderful evening. God bless you. Hallelujah, church. What a great day today the Lord's given us. Praise God. Hallelujah.